Today, let's turn to 1 Corinthians 10:13. But before I read the scripture today, I want to say a couple of words. It's a title on the screen. Don't think about snakes. Now, do not think about snakes. What did I say again? Don't think about snakes. Okay, there you go. Now, my sermon is not about snakes. I'll just tell you that. It is about overcoming temptation. Let's read 1 Corinthians 12:13. It says this, "No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, He will also provide a way out so that you can endure it." Now, some translations say the way out, which is a specific thing for each temptation we encounter. Now, everybody knows, most people, I guess, knows Pastor Mark. He has a great sense of humor. I got a text earlier this week after I sent him in the sermon title and all in the scripture. And it said here, quote, I noticed your sermon is about snakes, but you have a bear in your scripture. Oh, it's not up there. That's what God said. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. Ta-da. Okay. Now, from this scripture, we can see a couple of things, and one of them is that God is not just an uninterested observer leaving us to fumble through life, right? He is with us. When we are tempted, He makes a way out, and He is faithful. That's what the scripture said. He is faithful. Now, He knows also that we struggle at times with our temptations, and it's not a foreign thing to Him. Because in Hebrews 4, verse 14 through 16, it says this, Hebrews 4, 14 through 16. "Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest incapable of sympathizing with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet without sin." Thank God. "Therefore, let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and find grace whenever we need help." Amen. Now, I want to ask a couple of questions here. One, who here has never been tempted? Or who here has never sinned, even after you've come to salvation in Christ? Or am I, the only one up here having to deal with this? No, you know what that means? That means we are all in the same boat together. Okay? We've all been tempted, we've all sinned, we've all fallen short. But, there's another question I'd like to ask. Is a temptation the same as a sin? Or is being tempted the same as committing sin? I want to say emphatically, what? No, they're not. But, I hate that word, but temptation can lead to sin when we choose to act upon the temptation. We choose to do it. Just like Adam and Eve in the garden, when the devil said, hey, and they believed the lie. Then they went over and they grabbed the fruit. They reached out and grabbed it and they ate it. But you know what? That was theirs. Each one of us has our own areas of temptation. You have triggers that I don't have, and I have stuff that you don't have. We are unique in the areas of weakness where we can still struggle with temptation. We have our own triggers. We have the things that set us off and that we fall into, we're weak into, and mine aren't the same as yours, and yours aren't the same as mine. Those can come from past lifestyles. They can come from habits or sinful activities that we were involved in. But you know what? Thank God He makes a way out for all of us. In our fight against temptation and sin, I would like to give what I believe are ways to overcome, to have victory over, and to be set free from temptation. Amen? Now, the first one is this. Pastor Mark touched on this a couple of weeks ago. And it's found in 1 Timothy 6:11. It says here, but you, man of God, and I want to interject, woman of God. Amen? Amen, women? Yep, there you go. Okay. Woman of God. What does it say? Flee from all of this. But then it goes on to say, but and pursue or follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, and gentleness. And I would say with this area here, the first one is flee. That's kind of like when I'm going to fall into sin. I'm going to do it. What do? Get out of there. Run away. Run away from it. Get out of that situation if you're able to do that. Right? If somebody has a problem with alcohol, I don't say go to the bar or go to the nightclub alone or definitely not with your friends. Okay? Run away. Don't do it. Just get out of the situation. But the scripture doesn't just say, hey, run away from it and go stand out in the field all by yourself. No, it says to pursue righteousness, godliness. It says go do something else. And I want to say is that means go run to God. And go run to the church. Run to His Word. Right? Run to your brothers and sisters in Christ who can help support you and give you strength to overcome. Amen? Now, in that, I want to say, if you have an accountability partner, amen. If you've got somebody you trust, and I mean trust, they should have two big ears like this, like elephant ears, and one really, really, really small mouth. Why? Because they need to really listen to what's going on in your life and what you're telling them, but they have such a small mouth, they're only going to talk to you and nobody else. Amen? Amen? And if somebody has come to you to ask for help in this area, that is a sacred charge. Zip the lip. Amen? Amen. There you go. Because we need each other. We need to help each other. Now the second one. That one's flee. You're going to go there. Get away. Right? The second one is redirect. And we need to be careful in this area a little bit, and I'll explain it. Because we can start to focus too much on a temptation. And then not trying to sin. I don't want to sin. I don't want to sin. Right? And that can actually make it harder for us because that's what we're focusing on. Now, with a target, and you have an arrow, whatever you're going to shoot at the target, if you're aiming at the target, looking at the target, chances are, what are you going to do? You're going to hit the target, right? Now, if I'm aiming at the target over there and I'm looking over here, what am I going to do? Chances are, there's going to be a hole in that wall. Amen? Okay. Now, remember when I said, don't think about snakes. Oh, man, John, thank you. Now I feel like Indiana Jones in the first movie when they drop the torch down there and he looks in the hole in the big thing in the temple and he's like, ugh, and he rolls over on his back and he says, snakes. Why'd it have to be snakes? Right? Okay, I'll help you out. Here we go. Think about chocolate cake. Okay, think about a real 2-3-layered delicious chocolate cake. Okay? Now, think about chocolate cake. What are you not thinking about? Don't say it. That other thing. See, I'm being nice to you. Okay? Don't want to go back there. Cody is going to be my assistant now. To illustrate, because I love illustrations, to find a goal, here you can see what I'm talking about. Okay? So, here we have Cody, who's my son-in-law, so I can pick on him. Woo! Yeah. Oh. I don't need that. What happened? Okay. Yeah, you can. That's his wife. Okay. All right. This is Cody the Christian. Okay? Now, he's living his life. He's serving God. He's moving through life. He's helping people. He's doing things. He's working and doing and all that. But from time to time, he struggles with the temptation. Yeah. He struggles with the temptation. I'm doing this, not you. Anyway, here is, and especially when Cody is feeling tired, or maybe lonely, or depressed, down in the feelings, is down the mully grubs. And then also, you know, he may have his temptation come after a really great week, or did some event, he's really going really good, man, that really turned out real good. Then he drops his guard. We have to watch that, because temptation will come in then. Devil will try to mess with you right after a good attaboy, right? Come on over here real bit. Yeah, right afterwards, right? So, now, I have right here a small football. Everybody in the back can see me, at home can see me. This is a small football. Now, I'm not saying that football is a temptation. Well, it could be for some people. Okay, just saying, okay? Don't worry about it. Cowboys aren't doing that good. Okay. And every other Texas team, I think, lost last week anyway. Anyway, so here is Cody's temptation. He's living his life. He's doing his thing. And I'm over here going, hey, Cody, look at me. Uh-huh. Oh, hey, Cody, look at me. Hey, 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 over here. Hey, 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 over here. Look, 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 look. What else is he seeing now? Not much, right? That's all he can see. Why? Because he's focusing on it. It is becoming all-consuming, and his next step is reach out and grab it. No, no, mine. What? Just purely illustration purposes. Okay, so here we have. Now, what is he supposed to do to get away from that? Leave, you could do that, yeah. But in this one, if he's stuck right there focusing on it, what does he need to do? He needs to redirect his focus. Okay. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. What does it say? He said, because we have this great cloud of witnesses, let us therefore lay off every weight and sin that easily ensnares us or entangles us or weighs us down, and let us run the race that is set before us. Why? Because looking to Jesus, who is our, what is it? Author and finisher of our faith. So what happens when he's over here looking at this and he says, okay, well, you need to look to Jesus. What do? You start praising God. You lift your eyes and say, oh, thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Thank you for delivering me. Thank you for goodness. I just want to worship you and love you, just like what we did in worship service today, about the presence of God. And you know what happens to the temptation? What happens to the temptation? Cody, look at me. Cody, 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 look at me. And then it has no hold over him. It has no draw, or very, very, very little. And then you know what? After a while, he may not even see it anymore. Go, wow, I'm not tempted by that anymore. Amen? Okay, there you go. You can go sit down. So, one, we flee. Two, we redirect our focus on Jesus, not on our temptation, right? Three, we come at it against it in an opposite spirit, or an opposite attitude. And this is where I want to say we are tempted to believe or react to certain situations that come up into our life through other people and other situations, where we would react in a way instead of acting in the opposite spirit. It's kind of like when Jesus said, hey, when somebody slaps you, what are you supposed to do? Turn the other cheek, not punch them out, right? Or if they ask you to go a mile, what are you supposed to do? Go two. Amen. Now, in Proverbs 15:1, it says something like this here. A gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. And unfortunately, we all kind of like to live in the second half of that verse, right? You get in my face, I'll get in your face. You go, nya, 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 nya. What do? Nya, 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 nya. Right? But the first part is that opposite spirit. That opposite. If it's negative, we go positive, right? Amen? Now, on this whole area here of opposites, I want to look at this, and I think this is one of the most subtle types of temptations, and which is the most damaging, or could be, for us, because it happens in our thoughts, and those thoughts are about ourselves. That self-talk that we do all the time, even in the middle of the night, we believe lies about ourselves. Oh, I'm a failure. I'm a worm. I can't believe I did that. I'm a loser. I'll never, ever, ever change. You ever put always and never in a sentence? That's never a good thing. Or it's most of the time not a good thing. Okay. I'll never change. And we start to believe that. That comes from the devil. I'm so stupid and dumb. No, you did a dumb thing. Just like our kids. How many parents here, you look at your kids and go, wow, that was dumb. Right? We do dumb things as people. Does that make us dumb? No. And that's why I want to say, parents and grandparents and people, and interaction, kids, you know, siblings, don't ever say, you're dumb, or you're so stupid. You may say, yeah, that was a pretty dumb thing you did there. But you know what? You're a smart kid, and I love you, and let's do better. Amen? Amen. There you go. There's parenting counseling 101. Okay. What are we supposed to do with all this to combat those thoughts and that misinformation, those lies that want to bring us down and say who we are not? We need to go to the Word of God. We need to remind ourselves who God is and His character of love and acceptance and being in our lives. And we need to say, what does God's Word say about me? And what God's Word says about you as His child? We need to memorize it, quote it, speak it over our lives. Those promises of God over ourselves. And you know what? That'll start changing your thinking about who you are. Because the devil say, well, I'm this. No, you're not. I am the Son of God. I am a child of God. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. You know what? I'm not a loser. I'm the head, not the tail. That's what God says. That's what God's Word says about it. You know what? God's not my enemy. I am a friend of God. Why? Because Jesus said I was. Amen? Amen. Now, I want to tell you a story. Being missionaries, we went on our first mission trip many years ago with a man. And a van went down to Mexico. What do you do when you're driving down the highway? You run across, every once in a while, some very pungent smells. What am I talking about? Skunk. Right? And what does this guy do? He's driving along, and we're like, ugh. He rolls down the windows. We're like, what are you doing? He's like, isn't that smell great? I'm like, you're crazy. Roll the windows up. What are you doing? He did. He's joking. We thought we were joking around, just messing with us, right? And he's like, no, I think it doesn't it smell good to you? And I'm like, no. What are you, crazy? He said, well, now, let me tell you a story. Let me tell you the history here. As much as we travel around with the kids and all that, going from church to church, preaching all over the United States, you run across quite a few skunk smells, right? He said, we start out making a game about it. I'd roll down the windows and go, yeah, doesn't that smell great? You know, and everybody's like, ah, right? Well, it got to the point, we did it so many times and saying it so many times, we actually started to like the way it smelled. Now we kind of like it. I'm thinking, you're crazy. But you know what? That's a perfect example of a positive confession. Okay? So grab the Word of God, figure out what it says about you, and recite it and speak it and declare it over your life. Hallelujah. Amen? Okay, there we go. Now, got a question. You did the temptation. You ran away. You did all that. What happens if you get to the point, and you're tempted to the point that you are sinning? You sinned. You grabbed it. You did it. Right? Okay. For that, I want an illustration. I'm going to bring my Cody the Christian back up here. Yeah, bring me my jacket. Help me out here. I got a valet. Thank you. That's awesome. Thank you, bro. Appreciate that. Okay. You like my jacket? It's a new one. I do, too. Because it's on clearance. No, I like it because it's dark and it's camouflaged. You know why? Because temptation and sin is way more powerful in your life when it's done, when it's cloaked in darkness and secrecy. So just remember that. Keep it secret. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. I almost forgot. Would you bring me that bag there? No? Okay, hey. Oh, yeah. Well, I'm not letting go of you, bud. Okay. All right, come on back up. There we go. Here, hand me what's inside of it, please. Okay, I will help you. There you go. Are they straight now? Fix it up. Thank you.
Very nice.
Well, he's one of my best helpers, just want to say, right? Okay. I noticed you couldn't hardly do anything. It's pretty hindersome. Yeah. You know what? When you're shaking the hands with the devil, it hinders you in everything else you do. Amen? And it also robs you power and authority and takes away your confidence. It'll even try to redefine who you are. Now, you know what I like to do? I like to get you to sin, and then I'm going to condemn you for doing it. I'm going to convince you to do it, and then I'm going to condemn you for doing it. Isn't that a win-win for me? Wow. Okay. You know what? I heard this preacher say one time, sin will take you farther than you intended to go, and it will keep you longer than you wanted to stay, and it will cost you more than you were willing to pay. Keep you longer, keep you, take you farther, keep you longer, and cost you more. Amen? Now, what are we going to do with this? How does he get out of this situation? Kind of hard. I got a hold of him. Well, I'll tell you a secret. I'll tell you how. But I'm not real worried about this because most Christians don't do it. They don't follow the Word of God, right? It's found in James 4 and 7. And it says this, submit yourself therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Now, most of them, they only want to do the second part, the resisting part, right? Not happening. You can do that all day. I'm not going anywhere. Why? Because he's not doing the first part, which is submit yourself therefore to God. Now, let's go back a bit in the temptation phase. If he would have ran away, that's submitting. If he would have done a redirection and looked to Jesus instead of looking at my temptation, he would have run away. It would have been fine, right? I would have submitted to God. If he would have did the opposite spirit thing, the opposite attitude, and brought out the Word of God against me, that would have helped, but he didn't. I got him. He did it. How does he get out of that? Well, I'll tell you another, the real reason and how to do this, but I want you guys to swear to me, okay? Do not tell any other Christians this. Don't tell anybody this, okay? You have to keep it a secret. Because it says this in 1 John 1:9, if you confess your sins, God is faithful and just to forgive you your sin, and what? Cleanse you from all unrighteousness. So what does he have to do? Repent and confess. What are you doing? Stop that. Stop. Stop. Then what he can do, what can he do? Hey, okay, fine, I'm going. Thank you, Cody. When we repent and confess, that strips away the power of sin in our life. It strips away the power when we bring it to the light. Amen? Now, I hope y'all haven't judged me for getting silly behind the pulpit. But I hope to God that as you go out of here and you live your life and you serve God, and when something like this comes up, you'll remember, flee, redirect, opposite spirit, right? And that silly little hat, right? Confess, repent, profess, get right with God. And live in that victory and freedom that God's Word provides for us. Amen? I'd like to reread 1 Corinthians 10:13 again. And it says here, no temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. We're all in the same boat. But you know what? God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But He will provide. He will provide a way out. Amen? Amen. As we're invitation hymn today, if you need prayer or anything, if you don't know Jesus right now as your Lord and Savior, please come to the altar. Let's talk and let's pray. Introduce you to our Savior. Amen? If you need prayer or anything I've spoken about today, come on down. If you need any other prayer requests, we want to have the altars open. I'm asking a couple of the ladies to join us this time so y'all can come up and pray with them and elders we have here on that too. To come on down. Let's lift things up before the Lord and let's get the victory and freedom that God wants for us. In Jesus' name, thank you. Amen.